series, co-sponsored by the Great Northern LCC, Great Basin LCC, Southern Rockies LCC, and Plains and Prairie Potholes LCC. These are the four landscape conservation cooperatives that overlap the Sage Step Partner Forum geographic areas. The Sage Step Partner Forum includes working groups in the high grasslands and the shrublands of the western U.S. This forum provides additional collaboration on subjects such as greater sage-grouse habitat, and management across species historic range. This Sage Step Partner Forum is built around the LCC Partner Forum concept, which is a structured approach to collaboratively communicate conservation science information, tools, activities within large geographies, identify priority science products and information needs that are strategically aligned to meet the needs of specific agency program or partnership outcome-based adaptive management processes, and to seek alignment for conservation planning and action among organizations, jurisdictions, and landscapes. At the bottom of this slide, you can see the web link, and this web link provides a link to the Sage Step Partner Forum website. So we have a Partner Forum website that's a collaborative workspace that we call a wiki, so partners can provide comments, updates, have access to the calendar, upload files, and so on. The homepage of the website gives contact information if you'd like to become a partner for a member. And that website also provides a listing of the schedule of the weekly webinar series. And this webinar series that we're listening to today here runs from January 21st through March 18th. And each webinar will start on Tuesdays at 1 p.m. Mountain Time. If you're interested in learning more about the wiki on the February 18th presentation, yours truly will be giving a presentation on the wiki. Will demonstrate functional capabilities and have a lot of time for user comments, questions, and we really appreciate audience participation with that one. Today's presentation is given by Steve Knick with the USGS. Steve is joining us from Boise, Idaho at the Forest and Rangeland Ecosystem Science Center. And Steve's presentation is titled Maximizing Minimums, Mapping Basic Requirements for Greater Sage-Grouse. And at the end of Steve's presentation, we'll have time for your questions and comments. I'll read the questions and comments at the order they're received. And at any time during Steve's presentation, you can use the questions box or the questions pane to enter in those questions. And again, at the end of Steve's presentation, we'll have time for him to answer those questions. So let me give the presentation ball over to Steve here. And yes, Steve, once you get an opportunity, you can accept the presentation ball. And Steve, thank you for joining us and welcome.
Thank you, and thank you to the LCC program for organizing this series and to all of you for participating in the series today as well as for the other sessions. So today I've built my talk specifically around our work using to estimate ecological minimum requirements to map sage-grouse habitat, but also to understand what sorts of environments sage-grouse are selecting. But I also want to place that work within both a larger ecological interpretation as well as then a management and conservation perspective. And my goal is to help you understand not only how we came about identifying these minimums, some of the statistical procedures that we used, but also how to interpret many of the other things that right now are being discussed and are driving conservation not only of sage-grouse but sagebrush ecosystems. So I want to just start with some numbers because there's a lot of numbers floating around out there, and I confess I've also contributed a lot of those numbers myself. And so what do these numbers mean, and how do we interpret those numbers, and what do you need to interpret those numbers? And so the ones I've got on the screen now are 3%, 5%, 25%, 30%, 65%, and 70%. The kinds of things you need to understand, and these have all been used for different things, levels of disturbance, how much sagebrush we need, how much sagebrush we don't need, those kind of things, what kind of ecological condition for a landscape. We need to know a number of things. For instance, what is the thematic resolution that we're using? How are things categorized or how are things mapped? If we use a disturbance category, what does that mean? Does that also include agriculture? What does agriculture mean? Is that cropland, pasture land? So the thematic resolution is really important. Is it just sagebrush? Is it all big sagebrush? Is it dwarf sagebrush or tall sagebrush? Those things are a huge difference. But if we're only collapsing them into a couple of bin categories, that influences how we might interpret some of these numbers. The other components are a spatial resolution and the extent over which we're measuring things. How fine are we measuring them, and how broad an area do we expect these relationships to take place? The other thing is that these aren't magical numbers. They're relationships. They're cut points, thresholds, decision points, whatever it is you choose to call them, but they're numbers or, like I say, cut points at which we know on average we can expect this kind of a response, either in sagebrush or sage-grouse, in terms of either a disturbance level or the amount of sagebrush in a landscape in terms of the sage-grouse population response. We can change these numbers to anything we want, but we change then on average what the outcome might be. So rather than a categorical plus or minus, it's got to be below 3% or above 3%, just recognize that this is a continuum that we've selected and that along that continuum, on average, we can expect a certain response based on where we put that threshold or cut point for our management. So those are kind of the background things you need to understand these numbers. And the goal of what we did through the minimums paper is just try and understand how a sage grouse perceives the landscape. And this is a graph that I've shown many times, but it's important for putting things into perspective. So we have an organization, a hierarchical organization of an ecological system, in this case sagebrush. And at the one small spatial scale and temporal scale, we have shrubs and individuals. Moving on up through leks, sagebrush stands, through landscapes, into populations. The packs are priority areas for conservation, management zone, and then across the entire range. Each of these are important for understanding these numbers and for putting it into perspective. Most of what I'll talk about today kind of falls in that zone between individual stands, mostly centered around landscapes and populations. But again, it's important to understand what it is we're talking about when we use these numbers, like 25% sagebrush. Is that 25% ground cover of sagebrush at an individual stand, or is it 25% of cover of the landscape that needs to be dominated by a sagebrush community? Those differences get lost in some of the discussions I've heard, and it's important to keep those distinctions so that we're actually communicating in the same way. Resolution and extent, also very important. Resolution is simply the precision in space or time that we're using for the analysis. If we're measuring things on a meter squared basis, our conclusions are going to be very different. In fact, we might, referring back to that first hierarchical graph, then be talking about distances between shrubs. If our resolution is on the order of square kilometers or 10 square kilometers, then we're making different kinds of conclusions about how the landscape itself is structured. So it's important not only to understand the resolution, but to match the resolution to then the kind of observation or objective or question that we're asking. As I mentioned before, keep in mind there's also a thematic resolution, the fineness of detail with which we're able to characterize something. Is it simply habitat or non-habitat, or are we able to characterize more than that? And finally, the extent or the boundaries of the area or the period of the study. What is the spatial extent over which we're making these generalizations? Is it a landscape? A landscape means many different things to different people. So we need to define, is it on the order of tens of square kilometers? Are we talking about an entire priority area for conservation? Or are we talking about the entire sage-grouse range? And again, those numbers would mean something very differently depending on where we were within that hierarchy. And just for example, then I'll show you this. This is sage-grouse habitat in north central Washington. And at one spatial scale, a fairly fine resolution, we would say that, okay, this is primarily agriculture with some sagebrush mixed in. And at another spatial scale, we might say it's an agriculture-dominated matrix. To a sage-grouse, which is the important part here, how does a sage-grouse perceive this? Do they perceive this as a landscape to begin with? And then at different orders of selection, what parts of that landscape are they selecting? And so again, this whole interplay between resolution at which we're perceiving something, we're trying to understand how a sage-grouse might do the same thing, and also how we measure it. This is important with looking at just some of the recent decisions, and I'll go through just the kind of the background, what's driving a lot of the sage-grouse work, and try and relate how this kind of information fits in with how the decision process is going. In 2005, the first listing decision on range-wide greater sage-grouse, the listing was not warranted, and it was based on consideration that there would be at least two secure populations going into the 2100s. Embedded in that, then, is not only where are these populations, but what is a population and what is the habitat that's needed to support that. At that time, there was a feeling that there would be sufficient habitat in two areas, likely the kind of the Owyhee uplands as well as southwest Wyoming, that would be able to support sage-grouse populations into the future. In 2010, listing was warranted but precluded, and the concern there was that there was major concerns for habitat and population fragmentation, that the fragmentation that was being observed right now between populations was isolating populations as well as habitat. But again, the resolution at which that was being measured and understood still needs to be worked out. There are also concerns about the regulatory mechanisms, which I won't deal with today. The next status review is to be completed in 2015. And that's based on something called the three R's. Basically, it's whether or not we have enough populations in enough representative habitats to sustain sage-grouse into the future. But again, all of this requires that we're able to measure not only populations, but suitable habitat and the scales at which we're measuring at, and understanding how populations and habitat are structured and distributed, not only across space, but through time. So today I'll talk about then this work that we did to try and understand the minimum requirements for sage-grouse. And really, this is nothing more than just a little more complicated version of the stuff you learn in third grade biology about food, cover, space, and water. Like I say, maybe just a little bit more complicated. I'd like to acknowledge co-authors on this, Steve Hanser, also with USGS, and then Chris Preston, who at the time was with the University of California in Riverside. I want to go through some of the conceptual and the statistical foundation for the work to help you get that kind of background on what it is we did. Describe ecological minimums and just why is that important? How does that help us then understand not only sage-grouse, but why was it used for mapping? That then leads us into the ability to kind of map connectivity within or among populations. And then finally, I want to put this into a larger context of how this work might fit in with some of the work we're doing now to look at gene flow, genetics, and population structure, so that ultimately we can get a good idea of the habitat and population distribution, the requirements, and how we can best conserve the species into the future. So habitat mappings, there's lots of maps for sage-grouse, probably more maps for sage-grouse than maybe any other species that I'm aware of at this time. But yet, having an accurate range-wide map is very difficult to produce. So why is that? Why is habitat mapping so challenging? First of all, sage-grouse cover an extremely broad range. And that range covers so many different sagebrush compositions and configurations, and different kinds and subtypes of sagebrush, so that going from one area to another is extremely difficult. We can build models based on, say, this area south of Eureka that will accurately map that specific landscape in Nevada. When we try and then use those same coefficients or those same variables and move that map to someplace in Idaho or someplace in Wyoming or the real test, eastern Montana, those models fail miserably. We can fit a good local model, but then when we try and move it to a new area or novel area, we don't have the statistical inference to be able to do that. One other approach would be to just simply make things so general that we could construct a map for the entire range, but we might have something like shrub and non-shrub. Whether or not that's meaningful would remain to be seen, but again, we have this kind of trade-off between fitting models and then the predictability, as well as this, the resolution of the variables that we're trying to fit to the model and their applicability to be able to move that elsewhere and the generality of those variables itself. A lot of this also then depends on the availability of spatial data. It's relatively easy to do a map either from remote sensing or other aerial photography for one specific area. But having those same variables then mapped at the same resolution across the entire sage-grouse range, which spans 11 states and two provinces, is very difficult. So we're reduced to using data then that are general or easily mapped. And again, that precludes some of the other things that are important, like understory characteristics and other aspects that sage-grouse focus on in some of these broad range-wide mapping kind of exercises that we might be doing. One approach is just simply to go out by hand and draw polygons around an individual area and say, that's a good place for sage-grouse. That's essentially what's being done by each of the individual states now in coming up with these priority areas for conservation or preliminary priority habitats or whatever they choose to call them or core areas. But even then, now what you know about resolution and extent, think of the decisions that we're making by drawing those polygons. What are we choosing to include within these areas that both represents habitat but also non-habitat? How then do we then interpret something like this seen in Washington and then translate that as to a priority area in management? And then how do we impose some of these numbers, 3%, 5%, 25%. Is that within a priority area for conservation? Is it for a population? Is it for the entire range-wide distribution? That's why these putting it into the context of the extent and the resolution is so important. And again, we can go out and just map these, draw lines around these maps. The decision process that we're going through then ranges from individual stands. You know, is this really a sagebrush landscape when the sagebrush ground cover is less than 5%. We're making these kind of decisions when we do this kind of a mapping. And yes, you can do it. It may not necessarily be repeatable, and it's a huge effort. And as you look at some of the edges between states, you can see that the consistency may be a little more, or we could desire a little more than what's currently there. So that's why some of the empirical mapping work that we're doing might be able to help in terms of crossing some of these jurisdictional boundaries, but also by using empirical data, we can start understanding some of the relationships between sage-grouse and their habitat. So this is the study area that we used for our study, the western part of the sage-grouse range. And we did this for a couple of reasons. One is the dynamics between the western part of the range and the eastern part are different, not only in terms of climate, precipitation gradients, but also disturbance regimes. Fires and invasive plant species are much more important in the western region than in the eastern. And just the whole kind of the way sage-grouse populations are distributed and the kind of the understanding. So it made sense to go ahead and to limit our study to just this western-wide region. We use field data it was LEC based in that we used that as a focal point during one time of the year and looked at the surrounding area around these LECs. LECs are breeding areas for sage grouse, and they show up every year to go ahead and breed, and biologists show up at those LECs at the same time to count the birds, and that's how we get our trend estimates. But it's also a way to kind of look at the population distribution. We then constructed a multivariate model and then did some spatial modeling in a GIS. Now, I emphasize the multivariate model. I know that a lot of we're focused on sagebrush, and in some respects, if you have sagebrush or if you don't have sagebrush, you're not likely to have sage grouse. But if you do have sagebrush, that doesn't necessarily mean you will have sage grouse, because there are a lot of other factors that go into that. And I use this figure from Doug Johnson. Just looking at the spread around each percent distribution of sagebrush to show you that it's not as simple as just if you have this much percent of sagebrush, this is what you're expecting or what you can expect on average. Yeah, there is an average, but there's also a lot of variability, which indicates there are a lot of other things that are influencing why sage grouse are at a given area. So we used an multivariate model, and environmental variables for soils, topography, climate, land cover, and so on. It was a LEC-based analysis, so our analyses may not really show well some of the other, like brood-rearing habitat or wintering habitat. Our resolution was a 1 kilometer grid cells. That's the finest spatial unit over which we were able to make predictions, and our extent then was the 5 kilometer buffer around LECs. That's essentially our landscape for the analysis. The methods, we had 2,070, actually more than that, LECs to work with, but we oversampled in small populations to make sure that they were represented within our model. We used a presence-only model called the Mahalanobis D-squared model, or distance-based model, and I'll talk a little bit about that. Then we partitioned that to identify minimums, and I'll show how that works, and then converted that to a habitat similarity index that we could then map. We evaluated the model with LECs that we withheld, as well as we had some historic but areas that currently aren't being used by sage grouse, as well as the study area. So once we identified this set of minimum requirements, we mapped that, or the relative similarity to that mean vector or multivariate mean of requirements for sage grouse. So the closer you were to that vector, the higher score you got, the more similar you were to this area having the minimum requirements. The farther away, of course, the less likely you were able to have that set of requirements, and so the less suitable or similar, if you will. Then we interpreted that for key variables and then converted it to a connectivity function. So if you think about habitat, and I've called it a habitat envelope, but it's also kind of the niche that we learn about in biology as being composed of multiple variables. And each of these, if we assume some kind of Gaussian distribution, have a mean and then some spread around that. But that's generally the hyperspace or hyper niche that describes what it is a species is using within the places that when they're selecting habitats. If we look at the primary axis through this, which is kind of analogous to a principal components analysis or something like that, this is the axis that explains the most variation in the species in the species selection. We've chosen through an eigenanalysis then to explain the greatest variation by putting that axis through this hyperspace across the largest ellipsoid, if you will, part of the ellipsoid that explains the most variation. The optimum, if we think of some kind of Gaussian distribution or bell-shaped curve, would be where the maximum or the centroid of this variable or this axis. The problem with using this then, when we try and map habitats, and many other statistical approaches are based on that, is that you don't ever really have an adequate definition of an optimum. So when you go to a new habitat configuration, or one that you might have not have sampled adequately before, statistically, any movement away from that centroid or optimum point is viewed negatively. And so that's why a lot of those methods fail, because you can't ever improve upon what you have, even though you may actually, from an ecological standpoint, improve it. Your statistical improvement is shown as a movement away from the optimum that you've measured. So what we sought to do then is, rather than look at the optimum, go to the minimum. Each of these variables then contributes, and you can draw as many axes as you have variables till you get to finer and finer amounts of variance that is explained. Ultimately, you reach a point where you're not explaining any variation. This axis then, or plane, what it actually is what is relatively consistent across the entire distribution or set of presences that you're measuring. In other words, this doesn't change much. It's an absolute minimum set of conditions that a species uses. That then becomes your reference point, rather than an optimum, but rather what is the minimum set of conditions. Then you can measure away from that minimum set and get fairly accurate metrics then, or measurements of places that are suitable or less suitable relative to, can an area provide the minimum set of conditions. As I said, what we tried to do is then get the sage-grouse perspective on this, and, you know, just peer into the brain of a sage-grouse and what is it really thinking when it's selecting habitat. And that was our hope through this kind of analysis. So when we mapped that distribution, we came up then with a map that for the western region that looks something like this. And I would just note that, again, this is a relative similarity to an area having the minimum set of requirements. So it's going to overestimate what the actual distribution is. And just because an area might have the suitable set of requirements there, it doesn't necessarily mean that sage grouse are there, but it just means that the set of habitats is available that it could support sage grouse at those locations. And again, this is a map then that was seamless across the different jurisdictional areas and represented a relative similarity index to what sage grouse would require for the minimum set of requirements. If we zoom in a little closer, like to this area in Idaho and Montana, or Idaho specifically, and then use as polygons some of the population boundaries that have been delineated, we can see how habitat is then spatially distributed within some of these population boundaries. We can also start to see that between these populations are areas of unsuitable areas, and why is that? And again, whether it's a mountain range or what is it, but we can see how the habitat is fairly well aligned with the way the populations are structured. And then if we look at, for instance, this population where there haven't been any birds observed for a while, we can start appreciating that the connectivity to other populations, you having a suitable habitat within that region, just isn't there. And that may be why that population is isolated and eventually lost. How to understand this then when we try and put it relative to individual variables? We did something called a dose response curve. And the way to understand that then is that if we look at then the variable of interest, and so what we have on the x-axis is the sagebrush percent within the landscape, and remember our landscape again is the 5-kilometer radius. And if we go to any level of sagebrush, whether it's 10% or 20%, the black line then is the habitat similarity index. That is for the study area at that percent amount of sagebrush. So if we look at 50% of sagebrush cover within the landscape, for instance, we see that the habitat similarity index for the landscape is right about a little bit over 0.3. So we can then kind of estimate from that percent of that single variable what the overall HSI, or similarity indexes, for that level or binned category of sagebrush. We also know then from looking at the LEC locations that we can select a threshold, in this case 90% of the LEC locations. 90% of the LEC locations have a HSI of at least 0.22. So that becomes the threshold that we've used in this analysis. And as we've seen, we can set that threshold to any place, whether it's 98% or 99% or 50%, and change where that threshold might be. And of course, then by changing that threshold, then we would change where that intersection is with the variable of interest in the habitat similarity index. So in this case then, the threshold where 90% of the LECs have their HSI at 0.22 intersects with about 40% sagebrush. What that means then is for 90% of the LECs, the HSI value includes about 40% of sagebrush in the landscape at that value. Let's visualize that then, and again, to do that, you need to look at or consider then this extent, how large this might be. There are two thresholds that are starting to emerge right around 25% and 65% landscape cover of sagebrush. The landscape in this case is something between a 5 kilometer radius on up to about a 30 kilometer by 30 kilometer box window within a landscape. And so that 25% can be distributed in any number of ways relative to, as well as the 65%. But these are two thresholds that are starting to emerge. Within this landscape, below 25%, you're unlikely to keep sage-grouse for the long term. Above 65%, sage-grouse are likely to persist. That's a large area in the middle over which other things are playing out that are going to dictate how well we can keep sage-grouse within those intermediate landscapes. But again, based on our study and several others that are now being conducted, these are kind of two thresholds, the lower and upper threshold that are being developed. When we look at, again, that threshold for the 90% of the LEC locations, agriculture, again, that threshold is for most of the LECs that are going to be in an area in which agriculture doesn't exceed much more than 10 to 15% of the landscape. The one that's caused probably the largest amount of discussion is the percent of developed landscape, and that's where we get into this issue, what's 5% or 3%. In the paper, we actually came out with a figure of 3%, and how that was estimated was from moving the threshold down to 99% of the LECs. So if we were to use the 90% threshold, again over here, we would have concluded that 90% of the LECs are within have an area that have actually much less than 1% developed landscape. The thematic resolution on this is the land fire, land cover value for developed. And so it is strictly those areas that have been like urban or other places that have been removed in a developed status. That may be different than how others are mapping developed or considering developed when they do their analysis. We moved that threshold then down to about 99%, and if I were to show that here, we would move this threshold line from 90% down to 99%. It actually came estimated then the figure that 99% of the LECs were actually in landscapes that had less than 3% of the developed. But again, notice that these are just different thresholds and cut points, and by moving that threshold at different places, we get a different value, and on average, we know what to expect in terms of sage-grouse response and what we can expect within the landscape. And again, ecologically, and if you go back to that figure from Doug Johnson, we can see that 3% and 5% and the spread around that threshold is really quite large. Ecologically, it's quite not very, very large at all. Industry, however, this is huge, particularly in energy development or siting transmission corridors, because it means the difference between putting in another well pad or not. And so again, these are the kind of decisions that we're having to make on whether it's 3% or 5%. but I go back to is 5% then to be meant for the entire priority area for conservation? Is it to be meant for a 10 by 10 kilometer square? And again, those kind of issues have to be resolved before we can blanket some of these kind of disturbance prescriptions. The other part of then knowing habitat similarity or what sage-grouse use is how do they use that and how do they move. And so we converted that similarity index to a resistance surface. And we made the assumption that sage-grouse are going to move through a landscape that they like, and that if it's less suitable to them or more of a harsh environment, they're not likely to move through that. So we would essentially depict the landscape. If a sage grouse came across a new 1 square kilometer grid, how would it perceive that and would it be likely to move across it? So we converted that similarity index to a resistance surface and then used that to map movements and connectivity. Range, or for the western range wide then, this is the map of the predicted connectivity. The interesting thing is that looking within populations, there's a fair amount of connectivity, particularly within the large populations. For isolated populations and one in which birds have not been observed for the last 10 years or so, there's almost complete isolation in terms of habitat connectivity as we've measured it. The Washington population and the genetics again confirms that these populations are isolated from the core populations within the sage-grouse range. So we've made a start then at estimating connectivity using our similarity index and looking at how individuals might move through the landscape. Putting this within the context of the larger picture then, we've identified some of the habitat requirements and in this kind of hypothetical set of minimums that needed to support sage-grouse populations. From that, we can then start looking at the influence of landscape or development. We've got these models of connectivity. We can see habitat-wise or movement-wise where sage-grouse are not likely to move. What are the sorts of things that are influencing those movements? The next big steps then are we need to delineate the structure of sage-grouse populations. What is a population and how are they moving through this landscape? And is it a breeding population? And so the only way we're going to be able to get into some of this is to be able to look at the genetic structure. What is the gene flow within populations? And then we can start defining populations which are going to feed into these three R's of representation and redundancy and all that. Ultimately then, by having this combination of information, we might model environmental changes into the future if we know the minimum set of requirements, and we can apply that model to new and changing situations, as well as then how sage-grouse move through that landscape. Are some of the changes that we're going to see either through development or through climate change or even just habitat change in some of these disturbances, how is that going to change the movements? So looking at connectivity, and I'll just kind of briefly go through this to introduce the genetic project that we have going. If we look at connectivity based on the LECs, at the one extreme, if we assume that there's absolutely no movement between LECs, a bird is born in one area from parents that bred on that lek. The bird stays there. Each of these leks are isolated breeding units. We've got an awful lot of different populations out there. That, however, isn't likely reality. As is this reality, is it where if every other lek was connected to each lek throughout the entire range? In other words, if a bird down in California could conceivably disperse and end up in a population in South Dakota. That is the other extreme and is also equally unlikely. So how then do we really identify that structure? The only way to do that, we could try and do it through telemetry, but those results have been fairly limited. Genetic information is really the only way to get that. And these are samples that we've now collected on a range-wide basis to look at DNA. And we can use the genetic information then to identify population structure as well as gene flow, which is going to give us a much better picture then in combination with the habitat of not only how populations are dispersed, which individuals and gene flow are going from which populations to others, is there a net exchange from one population, from large populations, for instance, to small populations. The habitat information then gives us the likely corridors along which those movements are occurring. So the combination of the two then is vitally important to understanding how sage-grouse move through the landscape, how they perceive the landscape, and are they perceiving a 1 kilometer squared area as being unsuitable and going around it? Are they going over it? Does it mean nothing to them? And then how again do we really model sage-grouse from the perspective of sage-grouse habitat from the perspective of sage-grouse? Ultimately, then, we have a number of different techniques, looking here again at some of the bi-state population in California and how it may be isolated from some of the other core populations. We have a null model of genetic relatedness just based on distance, isolation by distance, but we can put other things in like mountain ranges, terrain, development, interstate highways, whatever, ultimately to hopefully get some kind of a way in which the genetic and breeding dispersal is being shown and how breeding is being expressed through population movements. To conclude then, I focused again largely on the ecological minimums as the foundation for a lot of the work we're doing. It's an interesting approach in terms of how we view sage-grouse or your species habitat selection. Rather than providing an understanding of what's the best that might be out there, but really trying to get to the very core of what it is that is necessary to support a species. And if we can get at that, then we can start looking at how to provide those sets of minimum requirements, as well as understanding then the relative importance of variables. It's a multivariate suite that's describing this habitat niche. And so for that reason, it becomes very difficult. A lot of people asked me, well, what's the minimum patch size? And it's a question I've resolutely refused to answer for almost 2 decades now, just simply because it depends. You can have a really good habitat patch, but if it's in the middle of a larger landscape that's largely unsuitable, it's not nearly as good as having some more dispersed habitat that may be of lesser quality, but within a larger landscape. Again, by using minimums, we're going from a different perspective of looking from what's the absolute minimum we need in a multivariate sense to what and how can we provide that. We can then model connectivity using that as kind of a basis for how might individuals might be expected to use move through that landscape. We really do need the genetic information, and we're working on getting that right now because that's vital to delineating population structure and measuring the actual rates of dispersal, not only for genetic information to tell us gene flow, but whether or not populations are really supplying and augmenting or recolonizing other populations. And if we have a population blink out, how do we facilitate dispersal within to that? Finally, we're back to the 3, 5, 25. I hope you got a different or a better understanding of how some of these numbers are derived and what sorts of questions you need to ask to interpret what it is we're really saying. And just simply for someone to say, well, the ideal sagebrush landscape is 70% sagebrush and 30% not sagebrush. Now we start asking questions, how large a landscape is that? What is that 30%? How are we measuring it? And what is the configuration then based on that resolution? So to acknowledge then the support I've had, again, my co-authors on this, Steve Hanser and Chris Preston, it's been fun. A lot of conceptual discussions as well as what does it really mean in an ecological context. My agency, the USGS, the state wildlife agencies that have shared LEC information and insights into sage-grouse movements and behavior and just telling me where some of this stuff makes sense and where it doesn't. The Fish and Wildlife Service that using this information as well as the Bureau of Land Management. I thank the support that I've received from all of those. My longtime colleague, John Rotenberry, who helps me with some of the spatial and conceptual dynamics of sagebrush systems. We have put this information then on the SageMap website, and I guess if you can access this webinar, then this is the location for it, or the web address, but you can just go to the SageMap website and you can download those maps that we've developed for this project and use them and look at them. And I'd appreciate any feedback if, when you look at a specific area, if it makes sense or not, just let me know, because that's helpful as we go through these different exercises to understand whether or not we're actually capturing it or not. So at that point, I guess now is an opportunity to ask questions.
Well, thank you, Steve. That was very informative and thorough. That was great. Yeah, audience, now is the time you can use the questions box to ask questions for Steve. We do have a question from Jason Lowe, and it says, he's asking, where do we find the ecological minimums in the paper? Are they defined by the HSI of 2.2, which is the same as 90% of LEX? Question mark.
The ecological minimums in this case is defined by the 10th partition. If you think of, again, this multivariate structure, one partition would be that broadest axis, or the axis that covers the most variation. The next axis, second partition, would be the second most variation. And as you go down through each of these subsequent axes, we use the 10th axis within this partitioning process to define the ecological minimums. It's in some respects both a statistical and a conceptual construct. It's statistical in that partition is defined by the coefficients of each of the individual variables. It's conceptual in that those variables define a plane or a set of minimums from which you measure a statistical distance or similarity. But the actual minimum is defined by the 10th partition that we list in the paper, and we give our rationale for that within the paper.
All right, thank you. We'll give the audience another moment to write questions in the box. As we're waiting here, I'll just tell everybody, recordings of each weekly webinar will be available on our YouTube channel. That's the GNLC, Great Northern LCC YouTube channel, and the links are available on the wiki site. And that wiki site is, it's a little hard to memorize, but it's sites.google.com/site/forum-sage-step. Okay, we have a couple more questions coming in here. One from Kelly McGowan. How could this tool be used to complement our suitability model being developed by Dr. Coates, USGS? Question mark.
I confess to maybe not knowing as much about the suitability model that that Dr. Coates is using. To me, they each represent a different kind of objective in terms of how we measure habitat suitability. One of the interesting things is then the comparison about how well they agree, and gives us an indication of, yeah, this might be a consistent, another kind of a meta-analysis. This is important, but also areas where they disagree. And disagree is not necessarily bad. It just simply says that the objective for which Dr. Coates's model is being done and the statistical approach being used has different kind of objectives as well as assumptions as the way the data are handled relative to this set of minimums. Taken in between using the two of them might give you a different perspective on if the absolute minimums are being met, but maybe not a certain set of other conditions that are allowing sage-grouse to be there, then the difference between the two predictions might help us understand just why that might be.
All right, we have two more questions from Teresa Bursk. The first one is, how do you explain the high HSI values in your Idaho example, greater than 0.9, with a lack of LEX? How should that habitat be treated, i.e., is it really habitat? And the second question is, for the Oregon LEX data, how do you work with the pending classes on the conservation status values? Thank you. And I can repeat those if you need, Steve.
Okay, so the high values for the Idaho areas, if I get this correct, again, it may explain that the set of minimum conditions is present. And as I said in the talk, that doesn't necessarily mean that sage-grouse are there, just simply that the set of conditions matches what we've identified as the minimum set of requirements for sage-grouse. It may also be that if some of those areas are isolated, they may have had sage-grouse there at one point, but not currently so. And so that would be another reason I could think of why we would have some of those high HSI values at locations where there may or may not be sage-grouse there. And that, again, is why you cannot decouple some of the sage-grouse population information from just straight habitat modeling. What was there was an Oregon-specific question.
Yes. Yep. For the Oregon LEX data, how did you work with the pending classes on the conservation status values?
I'm not sure. I guess I don't understand the pending classes.
Okay.
Can I get a little more background on that? But again, I'm not sure in what context that fits. Is it in the LEX data itself, or how that works?
Okay, she is responding here. It has to do with the classification for LEX activity.
We used LEX that had only observed activity within, I believe it was a 5-year period prior to 2007. So a lot of the newer LECs that have been added since then weren't included in this analysis. And we also were fairly stringent in making sure that birds had been observed at those LECs. So there weren't, these were actual counts then that had been observed at each of the LECs.
Okay, she also commented here, the red greater than 0.9 areas do not appear isolated. See slide 22.
Okay.
Okay, we can, should we go on to the next question?
Well, I mean, again, a lot of this is going to follow terrain, not necessarily a population distribution, and because it may be a lot of the red areas, and if we were to use, different thresholds and move it up to 0.95 or something like that, we would see more of a individual polygon effect. But again, it's measuring from the habitat variables that we had available to us the relative similarity to that index. There are other things that may be keeping sage-grouse populations disconnected, or more recent habitat changes that are changing or that have put barriers or discontinuities in those polygons. Am I still connected?
Oh, sorry, I was on mute there.
Okay.
Jason Lowe, yeah, you're connected. Jason Lowe has another question. Is the 10th partition in Table 2 of the paper where it says K equals 10?
Yes.
Okay. Creed Clayton has a question. How suitable is a landscape for sage-grouse that is greater than 65% healthy sagebrush, but also greater than 5% developed and greater than 10% in agriculture?
I'm not sure how, I mean, you can have that configuration. I would have to look in at that specific configuration. We just looked at univariate relationships between an individual landscape or an environmental variable and the HSI. We could certainly generate what would be the similarity index based on such a multivariate configuration. But yeah, it's true, you could have greater than 65, you could have greater than 5% developed. That's why the multivariate context is so important. You can have populations persisting under different sets of conditions as long as the trade-off in the different variables is still there. And that's why I think sometimes we get focused on one particular component because it's easy to kind of map that or to manage for that, as opposed to trying to understand the suite of factors that are help that are allowing a species to be there or not.
Next question is from Rick Soja. Do you have any insights about how this analysis might apply in Wyoming, Montana, South Dakota, North Dakota, and Saskatchewan?
We've talked about trying to apply it just to see how well it works, because the underlying concept is that if you can map the basic set of minimums and you've got that nailed, you ought to be able to take it to any new area and have it work in that area as well. We haven't done it. There's a lot of kind of other things that go on there. For instance, the land cover mapping becomes, particularly as you move into more of the sagebrush grassland mosaics of eastern Wyoming and eastern Montana and South Dakota, become the mapping of those variables becomes a little less accurate than what we may have been able to work with in the western part of the range. So we'd have to interpret our results not only relative to does the actual concept work, but also then do we have the same accuracy in the variables that we're applying the model to?
All right, that seems to be it for the questions. Steve, thank you for that presentation, that fabulous presentation, and all the great answers to those questions. And thank you all for joining us for today's webinar presentation. I'll remind you that recordings of each weekly webinar will be available on the Great Northern YouTube channel, and links are available on the wiki site. We hope you can all join us for the next webinar, which is Tuesday, a week from today, on February 4th, 1 o'clock Mountain Time, with Colin Homer and Cam Aldridge. They'll be presenting Forecasting Sagebrush Ecosystem Components in Greater Sage-Grouse Habitat for 2050. And as many of you know, the registration information is available on the wiki site. Goodbye and have a great day. Thank you.